had to have a trade agreement that would create good American jobs, raise wages, and advance our national security. And I still believe that's the high bar we have to meet. What I know about it, as of today, I am not in favor of what I have learned about it.
Well, fair to say that when a Republican switches gears on a critical issue, the lamestream media is up in arms, bellowing about how those rascally righties can't be trusted. But when a member of the left side sycophants do the same, crickets. Let us ponder that with what seems to be a daily dose of Ben Carson and a real facepalm from a media mogul in this edition of The Political Animal. The veteran Republican analyst who went to both Duke and Virginia and thus is completely confused every college football season, Ford O'Connell, paired with the veteran Democratic analyst, executive director of the Travis County, Texas Democratic Party, who swears it's a Republican plot every time the Longhorns don't win a national football title, J.D. Ginns. Gentlemen, thanks so much for joining us. We've got our football in there. I feel so much better. Speaking of sport, if you will, I got to come to you first on this one, Ford, with Kevin McCarthy dropping out of the House Speaker race. Late today, I saw this quote from New York Representative Peter King, quote, "We look absolutely crazy," unquote. Agree or disagree?
Well, I definitely don't think that we look like we're in control. And when you're not in control in politics, you look incompetent. Not a great moment, but I have to say this was an earth-shattering bomb drop in Washington today. But I have to think it was more than the Benghazi gaffe that got Kevin McCarthy out of there.
All right. Now, wait a minute. I'm not going to let you get away then. Not more than just the Benghazi gaffe, because you've also got 40 hardline conservatives who said, we're going for Daniel Webster. What else do you think pushed him out?
I don't know. I wasn't a fly on the wall in that room. All I can say is he looked real confident walking around the Capitol this morning, walked right in that room, and after two sentences, turned around and walked out. I have a feeling it was something more. What that something more is, I don't know. The House Freedom Caucus certainly flexed its muscle, but it took a little bit more than the House Freedom Caucus on this one.
Okay, J.D., now what can the left then do with this? Because when Peter King says we look crazy and there's a lot of people walking around right now saying that it is dysfunctional and there's a problem, how is the left going to attack?
Well, I think that it's interesting. You know, the committee, Benghazi committee, finally got its head on the stake. It just wasn't the political operative or, excuse me, candidate that they were looking for. The Republican Party is in disarray right now. It's clear to everybody, and anybody who says that's not true is not shooting straight. I hope what the left can do is find a moderate person who wants to govern, not shut down the government. So I think the Democratic Party will be looking for who emerges that really wants to build a coalition of people that want to work together in the Congress. And right now you have a lot of people in the Republican Party who see their job as shutting it down and getting nothing done. And that's not appropriate. That's not what the American people want. And so I think the Democratic Party is going to wait and see if there's actually a moderate that can be worked with.
J.D., to your point, your party definitely smells blood in the water, and you want us to hang ourselves, and there's no way that you're going to throw your votes in there. I will say this. We can actually come to this compromise. We just have to figure out who it is. Here's the deal. The House Freedom Caucus, what they want is a seat at the head table, and they were sick and tired of being thumbed down by Boehner. They want a couple plum committee positions. This can get done. It has to get done on our terms, though, not yours.
All right. Now, let's go ahead and figure that out. Maybe we'll see a compromise here. Ooh, I love it when we get that word in here every now and then between left and right.
Okay.
J.D., let me come to you next, because here's Hillary Clinton. In her book, she liked the trade agreement. In a 2012 speech, she liked the trade agreement. And now she basically, this is a full flip and a full flop by Mrs. Clinton. Yes, come on, you got to admit.
It is definitely a flip-flop from the Clintons, and I think it's okay. Well, one, I really do think it's all right for candidates to occasionally change their mind. But let's
wait a minute, Hang on a sec there, J.D. I'm going to stop you right there. Why don't they just say that then? Why don't the candidates just come out and say, you know, I looked at things and I made a logical choice, and this is why? Nobody ever says that, and neither does Hillary Clinton.
I think that's why a lot of people on both sides of the aisle are unhappy with what we hear from our politicians. We want to hear the truth. And so what we're hearing right now is a lot of truth from Bernie Sanders, and it's making a lot of sense to Democratic primary voters. And so the calculus has got to be made. Do you want to go down fighting for the trade agreement, or do you want to do what the Democratic base wants to hear, which is we're going to defend American jobs and defend American wages, and we should be looking at those as a priority. So I agree with where she's
okay, Ed, this is the on Hillary Clinton's part, this is the political flip-flop of the 21st century, and she's put us all on notice that in 2016 she has the convictions of a weather vane in Hurricane Katrina. Here's the deal. She wants to scare Joe Biden out of this race, and her left flank is wide open with Bernie Sanders, and she's sick and tired of Bernie Sanders walking all over her.
All right, here comes the last shot now. I'm going to let you both hear this. Out of time. Hang on a sec. I get you, but we got to move on. Dr. Ben Carson was on the radio program Marketplace on Wednesday. He was asked whether, as president, he would raise the debt limit. The host, Kai Ryssdal, was absolutely confused and gave him every chance to give a right answer. Here you go.
I would not sign an increase budget. Absolutely would not do it. They would have to find a place to cut.
To be clear, it's increasing the debt limit, not the budget.
Cut where you need to cut, because we're not raising any spending limits, period.
I'm going to try one more time, sir. This is debt that's already obligated. Would you not favor increasing the debt limit to pay the debts already incurred?
Restructure the way that we create debt. I mean, if we continue along this, where does it stop?
20 seconds to you, Ford. The man doesn't know what the debt limit is.
This is what happens when you're a political neophyte. Trust me, running for president is not for amateurs, and it actually takes a lot of hard work and a lot of time immersed in the issues.
All right, now let me get to you, J.D. Is the left going to use this as an attack? You don't see them attacking much to what Ben Carson says or doesn't say, even though he makes mistakes.
I think that what Ford just said is right, and I don't always like to agree with him, but he's not ready for prime time, and I don't think the Democratic Party is upset with the fact that he's in the front-runner position. Right now, the Republican base wants an outsider. They want somebody, and if they put up Ben Carson, I think the Democratic Party will be happy. He's putting his foot in his mouth after gaffe after gaffe, and we haven't even started talking about how he does fetal tissue research in the past, so there's plenty more to go on Ben Carson, but the truth is he's just not ready for prime time at all.
I think that's what a lot of the American people are maybe starting to understand, although, hey, look, his poll numbers are up, his contributions are up, they like the man, and that's what it's all about at this stage of the game. J.D. Ginns, Ford O'Connell, we like both of you, and we like it when you compromise. It's a beautiful thing. Gentlemen, thanks a lot. We'll talk to you again real soon. Maybe the man appearing before Congress Thursday drove up in a Volkswagen. Though if you think about it, it might not have been the best idea. The car coach is here when we continue on The Hard Line.